So my, as the first speaker, my aim is to set the context. So I propose to speak about four things first. First, to talk about what the law of contempt of court is. Second, to talk about this thing that is in vogue now, the law of sub judice contempt. I think that has received a lot of media attention recently. And finally, I will deal with the particular clauses in the bill that deal with sub judice contempt. I will explain why I think, in my opinion, they're a bit too restrictive of free speech, and perhaps what are some problems with the illustrations in the bill. So, with regards to the law of contempt of court, generally, its main purpose is to protect the integrity of the legal process. Because for all of us, no matter who we are, lay people, lawyers alike, the courts are here to settle our disputes. Some of our disputes can be very personal in nature. They can be family disputes, so your deepest, darkest secrets. Or there could be severe consequences. For instance, the criminal process, you are facing jail term, possibly even a death sentence. So what the law of contempt of court is meant is to protect our confidence in this system. Because effectively, we are submitting all these very personal problems, or we are facing a very severe consequence when before a third person, an independent arbitrator. So the law of contempt of court is meant to ensure that people know they will get a fair hearing, the third party arbitrator is independent, and that nobody will try to usurp the adjudication process. And this is why Singapore has the law of contempt of court. It is meant to protect the authority for courts. For the civil side in particular, this can be quite important because in a civil case, essentially the litigation is driven by two people, the plaintiff and the defendant. So what the law wants to protect is that people who have a valid case shouldn't be unduly pressured from not going to the courts. If you think your neighbor has been causing you problems, blasting the loud music, you should be allowed to bring your claim to the courts if you have a valid claim. Conversely, if you are being sued and, for instance, you think there's a valid defense to your neighbor's claim, then you should be allowed to have your day in court. You shouldn't be pressured into settling simply because maybe some people out there don't like you. They start a Facebook campaign and pressure you to just drop the case, settle, pay money to your neighbor because they don't like you. So that is the whole point of the law of contempt of court, to give some context. Now, moving specifically to the law of sub judice contempt, what this deals with is pending proceedings. The Latin word sub judice means under judicial consideration. So what it deals with is speeches, talks, comments, anything that is said about a pending case. So the main concern is basically the right to a fair trial. So I've alluded to that already for a civil case, but you don't want to pressure people into dropping their cases or giving in unduly. For the criminal process, sub judice contempt is descended from the UK system of trial by jury. Because in the UK, you have jurors, people, 12 people, lay people picked off the street who are asked to come into court and potentially decide on the what could be a death sentence. Okay, in the UK, they don't have the death sentence, but a very long term of imprisonment. So when 12 people are listening in judgment, you don't want them to be unduly influenced by certain things. Now, the classic example of sub judice contempt in the UK is disclosing prior convictions of an accused person. So I'll give you a quick example of a case about 4 years ago in the UK to illustrate why there is this law of sub judice contempt and why it is so important in the context of a jury trial. Now, in the UK, there was this an accused person who was accused of kidnapping and murdering a woman, and he was also accused of kidnapping another woman. So the jury was called to decide on his decide on whether he was guilty or not, and evidence was led. But what happened was, halfway, while the jury was deliberating on whether he was guilty or not of the charges, the newspapers ran a concerted media campaign, and I'll just read to you some of the things that the newspapers said. The mummy's boy who says blondes are not fit to live. He regularly used prostitutes and kept an empty flat near his home for sex sessions. At night, he would stalk nightclubs in search of young women, drug their drinks, and bring them back to the flat. He would invite friends over to share the captive girl around. Billy Murderer, terror of his women, 6 feet of pure evil. He said he raped a disabled girl. Mom of his kids, he raped me and burned me with cigarettes. He bragged about raping a disabled girl on a car bonnet in a club car park. So this was some of the things that was printed in a newspaper while a child was going. Now, obviously, no matter how reasonable you try to be, no matter how objective you try to be, if you are hearing this, you're deciding on someone's conviction, there's a very high chance that you would be unconsciously influenced. So in this case, the judge had no choice. He had to vacate the trial, discharge the jury, and call for a new trial. Because with such adverse media publicity, I mean, how can the accused person, even if he is guilty, how can he be confident that he's actually being convicted on the evidence, rather than on the basis of a media witch hunt, which may or may not be relevant? So this is what we're really concerned in sub judice contempt when we talk about trial by jury. We want to ensure that any man who is convicted in court is convicted because there is evidence against him, he is factually guilty, and not because of things he did in the past, things he did that are not related, not because you think he is inherently a bad man. So this is what I would call the classic case of sub judice contempt, but I would add that sub judice contempt, in the UK at least, and in what we call the common law, is not so easily made out. The test, as we call it, is a real risk of prejudice, or in the UK, it's called a substantial risk. So if I can go back to my earlier example, if you say such terrible things, you reveal his sexual habits, there is a real risk of prejudice. There is a substantial risk. But if you ask me if the newspapers perhaps just gave a very short one-liner that so-and-so used to be convicted in the past, or so-and-so, it was alleged that he had raped certain women, and if perhaps this was presented in not a sensationalist manner, less hyperbolic language, then I would dare say there is no real risk. Because ultimately, how you assess whether there is a real risk of prejudice is by reference to the finder of fact. So of course the jury is given firm instructions, they are told certain things, you have to fulfill a certain test before you convict. So simply because convictions by themselves are released out of the public and they know isn't sufficient to show that there is a real risk. Of course, if you know you go into such lurid detail, then the test is fulfilled. But the point I want to make is really that the test isn't that easy to satisfy, even in the context of a jury trial. So this brings me to a bench trial. So in the UK, cases have made it quite clear that if a judge is the sole trier of fact, so civil cases, for example, defamation, torts, or if a case has gone on appeal, there's very little chance of the real risk or substantial risk of prejudice being fulfilled, simply because the judge is a professional. He is trained to put all these things out of his mind. He's trained to decide facts as they are. He's not meant to be prejudiced. And even if the judge does read all these tabloids and finds out all these things, well, he's supposed to put that out of his mind anyway. It's part of his job. So UK law has made it quite clear that in such a case, all these tabloids, condemn the man all you want, say whatever things you want to say about him. It's very unlikely that there is a real risk of prejudice, simply because of who he is. He's a judge, he has taken an oath of office, he's expected to discharge his duty. So this is sub judice contempt in a nutshell. I hope you've understood it. I've tried to distill what is actually a bit of a complex subject in a simpler manner for discussion. So this brings me to the main part of my talk today, which is about the proposed bill. I don't have it up here, unfortunately, but you can assess the bill online, Google. What I will be talking about is Clause 3.1b.1 of the bill. This is the part of the bill which deals with sub judice contempt. Now, what I am concerned about this bill is that it doesn't actually reflect the common law position. So like I just said just now, the common law position is a real risk. It is what we lawyers love to call a balancing test. So freedom of speech is not absolute, but neither is the right to fair trial. So the real risk is how we sort of try to reconcile two competing and vastly different interests. But what I'm slightly concerned with about Clause 3.1b.1 is it does not reflect the common law position of a real risk, but instead what is the offence, how the offence is made out is if you make a prejudgment and such prejudgment has a real risk of prejudice. Now, prejudgment, unfortunately, is not defined in the bill. And if you ask a lawyer what does prejudgment mean, he'll say, well, if it's not defined in the bill, let's look at the ordinary meaning of the word, which is problematic because prejudgment can cover a lot of things. It covers simple, I think he's wrong, or it covers the situation I mentioned where you condemn a person in the newspapers. It's a very wide word. It could even conceivably cover even academic commentary on cases, which is obviously not the point of the law of contempt of court, because academics themselves are not trying to influence anyone, they are doing their job to comment on the law. Another reason why I'm concerned is because this phrase, prejudgment, to the best of my knowledge anyway, comes from a UK decision that was actually statutorily overturned, and it was criticized as being unduly restrictive of free speech. So let me give you some context. This was in 1974. There was this drug scandal at that point in the UK about the drug called thalidomide. It was a drug that was marketed as an anti-morning sickness pill, but unfortunately it had severe side effects. Pregnant women who took it ended up giving birth to deformed babies, or some of them even died maybe just a few months after birth. So there's a huge public outcry, huge demand on the drug company to settle, and of course the parents sued. And the drug company obviously didn't want to get caught in a long-drawn litigation, so they entered settlement talks. Litigation didn't really happen. But what happened was a newspaper editor thought that the terms of the settlement with the parents of the children who were born deformed or who had died, he thought that the terms of the settlement weren't enough. He thought it was too little. He thought the company should have taken more responsibility. And he began a newspaper campaign saying that, hey, wait a minute, this drug company has caused so much suffering, they should pay more. And in fact, he made it quite clear that that was his intention in this newspaper campaign. He wanted the drug company to settle and pay more. So the UK House of Lords in that case said, well, that's not right. You're running a media campaign, you're trying to affect the integrity of the legal system. So in that case, that was where the UK came up with this test of prejudgment. Before that was what I mentioned, the real risk test. Now, but here's the thing. The UK House of Lords came up with this prejudgment test. They were condemned roundly by academics. The European Court of Human Rights said, well, you just infringed the European Convention of Human Rights or freedom of speech. And the UK Parliament said, okay, you know what? We have to reform our laws. So they statutory reformed this and had in place the new substantial risk of prejudice test. But it should also be noted that the Court of Appeal, which is the court below the House of Lords, they actually said there was no sub judice contempt because, well, the comments in the newspaper article, they may be hard-hitting, they may be critical, but they were temperate, fair criticism. I mean, after all, it is true that lots of suffering was occasioned, and I mean, this is a matter of public interest. So why can't we comment about this? Where is the risk of prejudice? So that is the context of how this prejudgment test very, very briefly existed. It's been overturned. So my concern about the bill today is that we seem to be going back to a test which has been criticized and which occurred in a very different context, which is in the civil context where parties can be pressured, of course, to drop their cases or to settle. So, but in Singapore, if you ask me, do you think this has any relevance? I would say if it's a test of prejudgment, it would be too wide. The real risk test is sufficient. There is no reason why, as I say, temperate, balanced criticism based on fact, no matter how strong a position you take, I mean, I don't see why that should be I don't see a reason why that should be contempt of court. In fact, you are assisting the court or parliament, which brings me to another topic that I wanted to mention. And this is how actually parliament itself is influenced by public debate, public commentary on laws. So if you cast your mind back to 2007, parliament repealed section 377 of the Penal Code. This still makes it a crime to have carnal intercourse against the course of nature, which basically means oral and anal sex is a crime. What happened was in 2003, a police officer was tried and convicted for having oral sex with a 15-year-old girl. It was not disputed that it was consensual. He didn't force her, he didn't assault her, but it was a crime. There was immense public outcry, of course. People wrote to the Straits Times, they complained about it. They said things like, the authorities need to recognize how ridiculous it is not to modernize Section 377. Or, does anyone not realize how archaic the law against oral sex is? There is no reason why the law should interfere in anyone's sex life. Now, the thing is, during this period of time where all this public debate was going on, there was actually an appeal against, well, the police officer who got convicted was appealing. So if the sub judice rule today, if it was passed, if it applied back then, all this talk would technically be in breach because the sub judice period is still active, the case is still going on appeal, and under the law as framed in the bill, you can't prejudge there. And yet, Parliament itself, in the parliamentary debates, noted that this public reaction outcry was one of the reasons why they decided to repeal Section 377. They said that public debate made it quite clear that societal norms have changed. There's no point having a law that does not reflect the moral and social mores of society. So really, if this bill, in a sense, if it's too wide, if the prejudgment test is really what the if what Parliament intends is to enact a prejudgment test from the UK, then this situation where people's feedback actually affects parliamentary laws can't happen because you can't prejudge a case, which requires prejudice. So that deals with Clause 3.1b of the proposed bill. Okay, I mean, I would caveat it by saying that I really don't know where this prejudgment phrase comes from. To the best of my research, it comes from that UK case. If Parliament had some other test in mind, I will stand corrected. I'm happy to say I would have been wrong, but just based on my plain reading, this is what I think it is. So now I'll talk about the illustrations to the bill. I think I've used up a lot of time already. So the illustrations of the bill, and this has to do with sub judice contempt again. This has to do with what an example of sub judice contempt is. Let me just quickly read to you one of the illustrations. A is charged for rape of B. Z publishes in a newspaper an interview with A's ex-girlfriend, Y. In the interview, Y claims that A had previously brutally raped her and A had served a long prison sentence for raping and molesting other women. The prosecution is not permitted to disclose A's previous convictions during A's pending rape trial. Z's publication of this interview poses a real risk of prejudice to all interference with the course of pending court proceedings against A. My problem with this is that this is the classic example of sub judice contempt in a jury trial context, which I just talked about just now. In Singapore, if your past convictions are considered relevant under the Evidence Act, they can be adduced as evidence in court, so the judge will know. So in fact, we have cases where, say, even if you're tried for drug trafficking, you can be cross-examined on, say, your past as a secret society gangster, or how you've been peddling drugs to other people, if it is relevant under the Evidence Act. So in Singapore, really, our evidence law really allows a lot of evidence to be adduced, but the point is, it is allowed to be adduced. So there is no real risk of prejudice because it's admissible evidence. The judge is gonna hear it anyway. It's gonna be on his mind. So there can't be a risk of prejudice because there's no risk of prejudice at all. He is supposed to listen to all this evidence. He is supposed to make a finding on all this evidence. If it's relevant, so be it. The accused be convicted on perhaps his past history. If it's not, well, that's good. But the point is, evidence of convictions is admissible. I really cannot see how it can pose a real risk of prejudice at all. And illustration two, in my opinion, it is, like I said, it doesn't pose a real risk. Simply having someone, implying that someone is a vicious pub bully is, I'm hard-pressed to see how it's supposed to affect the mind of a professionally trained judge. And you have to bear in mind that in the state courts, judges see so many criminal cases a day. This is something they've been doing their whole lives. They're not a babe in the woods who are easily influenced by a tabloid newspaper. So I'm not sure how this actually reflects the common law position of sub judice contempt. I'm not sure how it actually protects the integrity of the justice system. So in conclusion, I would say that I think a bill for contempt of court is a good idea. It's always better to have something written down on paper saying what is or is not permissible. It's much easier for everyone rather than asking your lawyer friend to read a whole bunch of cases or a whole bunch of textbooks. And there are some uses for sub judice contempt, even in a bench trial jurisdiction like Singapore. For example, if someone is charged for an offense, and then a whole bunch of newspapers start condemning him as a murderer, they say he's already guilty, and then whoops, turns out someone else confesses and he is a murderer, you would have an innocent man ruined completely just because of a witch hunt. In which case, I would say sub judice contempt can play a role in preventing this sort of ruin of a person's moral character and his reputation. But if you go a bit too far and make the test prejudgment, I think it would cover perfectly legitimate speech. So at the end of the day, it's what we lawyers and judges like to call, it's a balancing act. Nothing is absolute, but what we want is a balance. So that's all I have to say about sub judice contempt. I hope that's been helpful for all of you. Thank you very much.